A very few remarks on. You see a Q&A button somewhere in your Zoom tool, and through that you can first ask questions to the speakers, and you can also vote on the popularity, and that will help me as a chair to pick the most relevant questions. During the presentations, I'll ask you to mute yourself, and I will give a message to the speakers 5 minutes before the end of their 18 minutes talk slot. So I hope all of that will work fine. And I'll give the word to Henrik by stop sharing. And Henrik, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Christoph. And thank you, Anna, for organizing this session. And thank the organizers for taking care of all these. So I should just make it full mode. So for making sure that we can have this session. So I will present a study on valuation of health risk in China. It's joint work with Yana Yin, who is William Marion in the US, and Chitu Chang, who is at Peking University. Maybe I should do like that. Yeah. So very brief about the background. There are many deaths over world related to environmental factors. So one estimate suggests 7.2 million, of which about half is related to ambient air pollution. And many of those occurs in developing countries or low and middle income countries. In this study, we focus on China. China has implemented a lot of policies recently to address its heavy air pollution. And as you know, it's very severe in many places, especially the big cities with a lot of industries and a lot of people. And all these policies comes at the cost, but so far, not very often China has implemented some kind of relation to like CBA or RAA. So in this study, we focus on valuation, and of course CBA is a powerful tool for evaluation. And one concern, of course, from a policy perspective is that need monetary values also for those kind of effects that don't have easy available prices. And I will not go into any detail about the value of statistical life or value of statistical illness, but it's a well-developed method, and it's simple terms reflect the moderate substitution between wealth and risk. And in this paper, we will refer to the variation of a mortality risk reduction and value of statistical life, and the variation of morbidity risk reduction as a value of statistical illness. And based on the models for the value of statistical case, as I refer to this here, is that it can be predicted that this valuation should be positive. People prefer less risk of death or illness, so they're willing to pay for that. One can also show that it should be proportional to the risk change, increase with wealth and income. And there's also other predictions on age, etc. But we're not going into detail about all the different predictions. And there is a quite rich literature on estimating the VSL or the VSI, but especially the VSL. But most of the studies have been done in developing countries, not that many in low and middle income countries. And since has been shown empirically that the values obtained depends on the risk context, the populations, their wealth level, etc., it may be troublesome to transfer values from developing countries to transferring values from developed countries to developing countries, so the transfers may be quite large. So it's important also to conduct these kind of studies in developing countries. And there are different methods to estimate these values. So stated preference, review preference, they both have the pros and cons. Later in the session, there will be a review preference studies where market data will be used, people's actual behavior, but we use stated preference in this study. And different methods, so continuation, good to estimate values when there's only one attribute, but in this study we're interested in several attributes, so we will therefore use discrete choice experiments. And you will see an example of that later that might apply. So the aim and objectives, well, the aim is of course to elicit monetary preference estimates for the evaluation of improving the air quality that will lead to risk reductions in a fast developing context, as we refer to it, that is China. And more precisely, objectives is to obtain VSL and VSI estimates that maybe can be used for policy purposes. And a more specific objective of this study is to examine if the values depends on the type of illness that we are eliciting these values for. And then the last objective is to examine the effect of self-protection on preference to reduce the risk. And when it comes to self-protection, so we can rely on the government to reduce the risk of different type of illnesses, diseases. Now we are in a specific situation with a pandemic, but we can also do it ourselves. So we're all now very familiar with masks, but also you can use air purifier to reduce the risk of negative effects from air pollution. But you also have, you can use water purifiers, you can drink bottled water instead of tap water if you're concerned about the tap water quality, helmets when you ride a bike, etc., etc. So intuitively, we can imagine that if we engage in self-protection, we are less willing to pay for more protection from the government, but can be shown that it can go in both directions. So self-protection can also signal that you're very concerned about the risk. So if you engage in self-protection, you may actually have a higher willingness to pay. And the evidence from literature is mixed. You can show theoretically that can go both ways. And also empirically, there's been studies that shows that either self-protection increase wins pay or decrease wins pay. And since we have a chair here, I would like to refer to one of his works on this, where I found that when it comes to skiers, those who spend more on safety, and they were also willing to pay more for additional safety, that is in this case, more information. So here we have information about mask usage and also air purify usage that will be used when we analyze the data on this aspect. So the survey that we used, we conducted a web panel in Beijing. We had about 1,100 respondents, relatively representative of the internet-enabled population, age 20 and above, slightly younger and more highly educated than the general population in Beijing. Survey consists of six different sections. We have the warm-up, where we focus on air pollution and health and risk. We also added some other questions not related to air pollution risk, just to mitigate the risk that there was too much framing on air pollution and the risk of that. And then in the second section, we discussed the illness types and was a risk tutorial. And we spent a lot of effort here to make sure that the respondents understood the different illnesses that they faced. And also we know about the difficulty of understanding small probabilities and changes of those. So we spent a lot of time on showing visual aids and also having questions to kind of nudge respondents to think hard about the risk levels that they faced. And then the elicitation of wins pay, as I mentioned before, we used a discrete choice experiment. We had a split sample design, so each respondent only saw one illness type. It was to facilitate for them to understand. We had a lot of focus groups. It came up that it was a bit messy to have, you know, different risk levels of illness types. So in the end, we decided for a split sample design. And the design itself, the efficient design, 48 choice sets, respondents faced eight questions or eight choice sets, and they were randomly assigned to respondents. Then there was a question about self-protection measures, and we also had a section on continuation that's not analyzed here. But that, so in this scenario, I would like to stress, we have a public framing of the risk scenario. So it's a government policy, whereas a continuation question was a private area, but it's not analyzed here. And then background question and socioeconomics and demographics. So this is an example of the choice set, and at the bottom you see this visual aids that were used to try to help respondents understand the risk question. And we used the same type of visual aids in section two, where we trained them to understand this type of question. So there's one status quo, two different programs where there are four different attributes, reducing the risk of death, reducing the risk of illness, a time variable when the policy would be effective, and then the cost to the respondents. And in the visual aid, we included both the risk related to the illness in this case, and also the total risk, again, to try to mitigate the risk of framing. And red there is death, and then the passing the frame is related to the air pollution, and then the blue then related to that is the effect from the program. I'm not sure you can see it in this short, in this small image. Empirical methods, at the bottom here you can see the paper with details, because I don't have the time to go into the details about them, but to examine the robustness of our findings, we run many different models and also a lot of regressions. Many of them are in the paper, a lot in the appendix. But we did a multi-modal logit or conditional logit model, which is kind of the usually default in these kind of studies. And then we used the mixed logits and the latent class analysis to take into account unobserved heterogeneity. And then we also used the integrated choice and latent variable model when we looked at the self-protection. So the results, sorry, not yet. Attributes and the levels. So mobility, mortality, as I stated below, they were both presented as reduction in risk. So we expect a positive effect in the regression. And they were presented as a baseline risk of a 10-year time period to make the risks or levels larger to make it easier for the response to understand, but then it was your framing. Delayed years before effective, so either zero delay or 2, 5, or 10 years. One can ask whether it can be realistic from an expert point of view that there could be an immediate effect of these programs, but we had discussion about this, and we think that it's feasible that it's and that was feedback we got from the focus group, that it's understandable that there can be an effect immediately.
Could you stop?
Likelihood of death. So we also we wanted to have risk that you may be ill, but you may also have a high chance of not dying from. So results. So I will not go into any detail here, but what you can see from these results. So the first three columns with results are from the multinomial logit model, and the three last are from the mixed logit, and they're overall quite similar. We have expected results, so expected coefficient sign and their significance. So people prefer a program that reduces the risk more. They prefer a program that have a more immediate effect regarding the benefit, and they prefer programs that are less costly.
And we can also have five more minutes.
Pardon?
5 more minutes.
Thank you. And we can also see there is a significant heterogeneity in the data from the mixed logit standard deviation results. But results are quite similar between the two. The only exception is that in a mixed logit, we find that the stroke subsample, they dislike the status quo and prefer the program on average. But you can also see below that the VSL and the VSI values are not that different between the models. They are slightly higher in the mixed logic, but they're not significantly different, statistically significantly different. So both the VSL and VSI are not very dependent on which model one uses. We then here have the result. We have a lot of other results in the paper, but I don't have time to show them. We don't have results from the model where we include self-protection. And the indicators related to the different type of self-protection that we have, you can see that what could be considered a more effective self-protection measure, so the air purifier and the high protection efficient filters, have a bigger effect on the measure here. And regarding experimental variables as well, we have those we can assume would self-protect more, having a positive effect here, which is in line with our expectations. So age, female, higher education, if they're kids that they're concerned about, and also income, and if they live alone. And when it comes to the choice model, what we can see in the lower part on the right is that when we interact this latent self-protection variable with the different attributes, we find that those who self-protect more, they dislike the status quo more, so they're more in favor of the program, and they're also less sensitive to the costs of the programs. So this would suggest the last one about the cost, that they have a higher willingness to pay compared to those who self-protect less. So we run a lot of models. In the end, we didn't find, so that I should have said, that was one of my main points. As you can see here, the VSL and the VSI don't differ much between the different illness types. So we don't see that the willingness pay depend on the type of illness. So, and this was, we've done a lot of different regressions where we couldn't find any effects on the illness type, or just very weak ones. So we decided to merge the data. And then since we found unobserved heterogeneity, we also decided to run a latent class model and to use that for our kind of preferred values, those values that could be considered for policy purposes. So we run a latent class model with three classes. And you can see here that class three, they don't react to the choices that we'd expect. They're not affected by mortality, mobility. They prefer the status quo. And the only thing that they react to is the cost of the program. So below the coefficient estimate, you have the VSL estimate. So class two value the risk reduction significantly higher than class one. And then the estimate that we use for preferred values is a weighted mean of these two classes. So class three was not used because they didn't behave as we expect. So we're not sure if we can trust those values. So the latest case obtained higher than earlier Chinese studies. So the VSL is about 1.6 million US dollars. The VSI is about a quarter million US dollars. So higher than before, but in line with recent findings from Hammett and others in general risk uncertainty last year, who conducted a study in with the same kind of setup in 2005 to 2016 and found a significant increase in the winners pay among Chinese to reduce the risk. And this is also in line with what we, this can be sort of with our finding that even if Chinese now engage in a lot of self-protection, they also have a higher risk pay for the public programs. So it's in line with our finding self-protection. One of the main research question we had when we started this project was whether there was an illness effect on VSL and VSI. And basically, no matter how we run the analysis, we do not find any effect. And one could then say maybe it's because people didn't understand and care about the risks. So we paid a lot of attention to make sure that we were clear about what were the symptoms, etc., so it was clear to the respondents. And well, I think this is probably an appropriate question to look at to see whether these findings are robust. But I think we did everything according to the book and paid a lot of attention to make sure that presentation sets were clear. All right, and for those interested in this work, I think this week or last week was accepted to the Journal of Environmental Economics and Management. So hopefully very soon it will be available as an article in the press. And there you will also have a footnote with a link to the survey itself that we use if you're interested in that. And for those who are not very familiar with Chinese, it has been translated to English. So that's it.
Thank you, Hendrik. Just in time, and I give now the word to Milan Skasny, who will be the discussant for this paper. Milan, yeah. Floor is yours.
Thank you. So we just agreed with Anna to share effort. So Anna is going to present our paper, and I'm going to present my comments on Henrik's paper. And I also ask Anna just to share maybe her screen just to save time, because she will be using her computer to present our presentation. Yeah, it's going. Thank you, Anna. So I have. So first of all, Henrik, let me congratulate that your paper you just presented has been just accepted for GIM. It's a great achievement. So my congratulations. So what to add more? I have only a couple of comments on design econometric model and design econometric model and results. So first, you wrote in the paper that you restricted morbidity risks, so illnesses, to be non-fatal cases to avoid confounding it with mortality risks. But Henrik, really, when I read your paper, you just described that there is some probability of death, you know, for each of these three illnesses, as you can see here in my slides. I just took it from your paper. Moreover, when you presented the grid with 100,000 squares, you just placed red squares just after yellow, and the former indicated death, and the latter indicated illnesses. So actually, they might be a bit confused whether these two are additive or maybe somehow joined. Maybe you might think whether it might lead to another type of model or to maybe control for some interactions or whatever. So I wasn't really convinced whether morbidity risks were fully or completely non-fatal cases. Second, the program and payment will both last for 10 years. And on your choice card, you just said that it's the payment, one-time payment for this year, if I remember. So I was not sure whether they really considered they are going to pay for 10 years. Of course, it would not have any effect on the model or VSL estimate, but it might matter whether they agree or not with the bid if they were asked to pay only 1 year or 10 years. So Anna, please, the next one. regarding econometric model, so you estimated mixed logic, but I did not find anywhere whether you assume that all random factors were fully and freely correlated. Maybe you just may add it somewhere in the footnote. Then you restricted beta 3, that is actually a coefficient to indicate implicit discount rate, to be the same. So discounting risk of dying and risk of getting a certain illness. So have you checked whether these two coefficients are the same, because you just restricted they are just the same in the model? The third, mortality and morbidity, the risks, both risks are conditional to survival. So properly, I think it would be good if you multiply risk reductions, discounted risk reductions by probability of surviving X years, 2, 5, or 10. And as I found that the alternative specific constant for status quo is always significant negative, but sometimes we might end in troubles, you know, having alternative specific constants. So I'm just curious whether you try to estimate a model without alternative specific constant to have just attributes relevant to a program. Next one, Anna, and last. And here are my results for three models. You found a huge unobserved heterogeneity, in particular for alternative specific constant for status quo. And the coefficients for standard deviation is more than 10 times larger. So I was really surprised how it is large. Of course, I was not surprised it's significant. And this importance or this heterogeneity was also confirmed in your second models, latent class and hybrid model. So I somehow like that you also added these two types of models to maybe show more what you found in mixed logic. In the hybrid model, results from hybrid model with latent variables are considered less suitable to provide recommendations for VSL. But if you look on the results table I just copied on the right hand side, the coefficients for mortality and morbidity, the key regressors or key variables, are not really strongly significant. So I was really expecting that they would be the estimate will be stronger even for hybrid models. So actually what you only found it's strong significant effect is alternative specific constant and costs. And last, for latent class model, so you assumed three classes and then you estimated weighted VSL, but you considered only two. And actually, you just wrote that the estimates are not applicable, NA. I think since the coefficients are not statistically significant at any convenient level, so properly speaking, VSL is zero. And then you should consider, I think, zero estimate for this class three while deriving weighted average of VSL. And then weighted VSL would go down to 4.2 million, not 5
million. Milan, I need to interrupt you here because otherwise Henrik will not have time to respond to your...
This is my last word.
Okay, word. Perfect. So then I give the word to Henrik back. If you want to briefly respond to Milan's comments, Henrik. Are you there, Henrik? Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but I haven't unmuted myself. Just regarding the last comment, so class three wasn't included in the weighting. So we weighted based on just class one and two. Take into account then when we weighted that class three is not included. So if you go back to the first slide, one key comment was about illness, because that's one of the main question we looked at. So the description here is from the illness type description in section two. And then in the section where we looked at the win space, so the discrete choice experiment, there it was stressed respondent that there were two different types of risks. Then of course, whether or not they really understood that, it's another question that's hard to really follow up on, because it's hard to ask them, did you understand? Probably they would say yes. But we made a lot of effort. So the description here is from the correct description of illness types. And then we had the section where we ask about the means pay, where we said that it was not a conditional risk, the death risk. And then, of course, yeah, the 10-year long time period could have been added on the visual, sorry, on the choice sets. Good question. Good comment. We can't do much about that. Yeah, the visual aid. We have seen many studies that use the same, where they put together all the different types of risk at one end of the visual aid. But maybe, as we said, it would be better to maybe put the illness risk above and the death risk below to separate them to make them make that distinction clearer. But here, I think we follow many others who have worked on this and use the same type of visual aid.
Okay, Hendrik, I need to interfere here because otherwise we are running out of time and that would be unfair to the other speakers. I see there are two questions in the panel. I will, if there is time at the end, I will pick them up again for you, Hendrik. Okay. But now I want to move on to Anna's presentation. Anna, you do have the floor.
Okay, thank you. Give me 1 second to switch to my own presentation. I guess I wasn't quite ready. How am I doing screen-wise and how's my voice coming across?
Loud and clearly.
Oh, very good. And for the time being, no fire engines and no sirens, so we're good. So I'm presenting a paper that I co-authored with Milan Chasny, who of course was just commenting on Hendrik's paper. So the paper is entitled On the Validity of the Estimates of the VSL from Contingent Valuation, and we're gonna be bringing evidence from the Czech Republic. So I'm fortunate that the majority of the hard work of presenting what the value per statistical life is has already been done in the previous presentation, so that's wonderful. I just wanted to remind the audience that the value per statistical life is really the willingness to pay for a marginal change in the risk of dying. There's different types of risk of dying, and we're going to be coming back to that in this presentation. I also wanted to remind the audience that in many countries, the VSL is really an important input in many benefit cost analysis for specific policies. And in the US in particular, it's very widely used. It's used by different agencies, and they even provide you, at least the Department of Transportation even provides you with a formula for updating the value per statistical life for every year that goes by in proportion to the growth in income. So we also know, and we're going to be seeing this throughout the session, that the VSL can be estimated in a number of different ways using revealed preference, using stated preferences, and of course, I'm going to be focusing on stated preferences, just like in the previous presentation. We're going to be talking about validity. So by validity, we're going to be meaning how well the study has measured the underlying outcome of interest, which in this particular case would be the willingness to pay for a specified risk reduction. I'm going to be following in my thinking and in my presenting a paper that came out a couple of years ago in Environmental and Resource Economics, a paper by Bishop and Boyle, which does a very, very nice discussion of the different type of validity and their implications in non-market valuation, both for stated preferences and and revealed preferences. So in this presentation, I'm going to be focusing on three different types of validity. The first one is what we call the test-retest reliability, which essentially means the following. If I repeat the same contingent valuation survey using exactly the same questionnaire, using exactly the same sampling procedure, and ideally on a very similar population, am I going to be getting similar results in terms of the VSL and the willingness to pay for the specified risk reduction? Issue number two, construct validity. So this is actually something that maybe amongst us, amongst the panelists in this particular presentation, we know as internal validity. So we want to make sure that the willingness to pay is essentially following fairly faithfully the prescription from economic theory. And finally, we have criterion validity, which means what happens if I compare the estimates of the VSL from a stated preference study with those that are coming from a different type of study that uses a different method, maybe a method that people tend to be accepting more, such as a compensating wage study or something like that. So these are going to be the three things that I'm going to be focusing about in this particular presentation. Why is validity important? Well, first, because we're talking about stated preference studies here, and you guys know even better than I do, or just as well as I do, that a lot of economists and a lot of people out there are very skeptical of stated preference studies. And so it's very important for us to show that when we're doing a study, it really meets all of the most important requirements for validity. Also, remember that a lot of the studies that we're doing nowadays, especially those that are eliciting the value per statistical life, are going to be transferred to other locales. So there's going to be a benefit transfer taking place. And so it's very important to show that the original study really meets validity criteria. I also would like to point out that the value per statistical life is used in a number of different policy analyses related to safety or environmental protection or public health. And many of the mortality risks that we're talking about are really different in nature. You can have the risk of dying in a car accident, the risk of dying because of cancer, the risk of dying because of, unfortunately, some other disease. We really want to see how much correspondence, how much similarity there is across all of these different type of risks. I also would like to mention that lay people, so the very same people that we interview in the course of a stated preference studies, frequently have a hard time understanding probabilities. This is something that has been, we're talking about difficulty both at the numeracy level, so understanding that 1 in 10 is actually larger than 1 in 100, for example. But also there's a matter of perception. It's very well known that people seem to be overstating very, very small risks and understating larger risks. And so things are fairly complicated from this point of view. If people have a hard time understanding one type of probability, imagine what happens in a study like the one that I'm presenting today, in which we're presenting a risk that is actually described by two probabilities. And unlike the paper presented by Henrik, we're not talking about a risk of two distinct outcomes, one that is illness but non-fatal and one that is illness and fatal. We're talking about really the same thing, but described by two probabilities, as we will see in just about a minute. So these are our research questions for today. We want to measure, we want to check reliability. So we want to see if the cancer VSL, and we will be talking about a specific type of risk, which is the risk of dying from cancer. We want to see if that remains stable over two waves of surveys that were done in the same country using the same procedure about 5 years apart. We want to see if it's the changes in income that explain just about any differences that we can find, or if there is something else. For instance, the preferences for safety could have changed across over those 5 years. We want to check internal validity, so we're going to be doing the basic checks, and we're going to be paying a lot of attention to what people call the scope effect, which essentially tells you that the willingness to pay for a specified mortality risk reduction should be increasing with the size of the risk reduction, and ideally, it should be perfectly proportional to the size of the risk reduction. We also want to check if the willingness to pay increases with income, and if so, we want to find out at what rate, because this is going to be very important for policy purposes and for benefit transfer. And finally, we want to do a criterion validity type of check. So we want to see if the estimates that we can come up with are really comparing well with alternate estimates coming from other methods. So as I mentioned, we're doing stated preferences. We will be doing them in the Czech Republic. And unlike Henrik, who was using discrete choice experiment, we're going to be doing single bounded dichotomous choice contingent valuation questions. So you will see in just a minute that the physical, the graphical presentation of the questions very much looks like a discrete choice experiment. But the nature of the questions themselves is not. They're really a sequence of single-bounded dichotomous choice contingent valuation questions. We do a total of 7 per respondent so that we have an opportunity to vary the different things that describe the risk and to collect more data. And we do the survey twice. So we did it the first time in the Czech Republic back in 2014. That sounds like a lifetime ago. And then we did it again in 2019, again in the Czech Republic. I would like to point out that between 2014 and 2019, the Czech Republic actually experienced a period of fast economic growth. And actually, if I remember correctly, even household income grew by about 20% over those 5 years, which is a fairly remarkable accomplishment. So just to explain briefly what the respondents are valuing, I'm gonna be breaking down the presentation of the commodity to be valued step by step. So we're going to be starting with the status quo, your current situation. This current situation describes a certain probability or risk of dying from cancer. And of course, you're going to be dying from cancer only if you get cancer in the first place. So we can break down this probability into the product of the probability of getting cancer. I don't know if you can see me use my cursor as I speak. Multiplied by the probability of dying from cancer, conditional that you got cancer in the first place. So we're doing this fairly basic type of decomposition of the probability. We start with giving this initial background or baseline probability the same for every respondent. And we're telling them that this is going to be 25 in 10,000 over 5 years, which of course is equivalent to 5 in 1,000 per year. The probability of dying from cancer conditional on getting it in the first place is going to be 40% at 5 years. So we're essentially following the same type of presentation of the probabilities that you will find if you go to the CDC and you're searching any type of illness that is fatal or any type of cancer, or if you go to WHO and you're looking up at their information. It's typically broken down in this way: incident and then survival at 5 years, or mortality at 5 years. We actually presented in the terms in terms of survival, because I don't have the heart to be talking about two horrible things in the same survey. So how do we reduce the risk of cancer death, which is really what we want to elicit the willingness to pay for? So we either reduce the risk of getting cancer, holding the other risk the same, or we reduce the probability of dying from cancer, holding the risk of getting cancer the same, or we do both. So we reduce both and we are achieving an even bigger reduction in risk. We vary the sizes of the risk reduction across the respondents and also within the respondents, because remember, we have a total of seven of these questions. So this is the screen for each of the choice card, or the seven choice card that the respondent gets. So we have the current situation described by the risk of getting cancer. So 25 in 1,000 over 5 years. The chance of 5 year survival. So this is the baseline, which is 60%. We also have a couple of other descriptions which didn't prove to be particularly important. So we're not gonna be spending a lot of time in this presentation, but that would be a quality of life and a pain type of impact that you may have from cancer. So in this case, this person is actually unable to work and is gonna have just mild pain. And then we have the cost to the respondent, which of course is zero if you're in the current situation. We're presenting you with an option of reducing these risks. So we're going from 25 to 20. We're increasing the chance of surviving here from 60% to 70%. We're keeping the effects on everyday activities the same. And then of course, here's an amount. This one is expressed in pound sterling, because in the very first survey, so the one in 2014, we did it not just in the Czech Republic, but also in the UK. And I happened to have this particular slide ready. We are presenting the risk using the traditional grid, which is going to have a bunch of white, so a white square. So if you're landing on the white square, this is your probability of surviving. And of course, we have the blue squares, which represent the remaining probability of dying after you get the risk reduction, which is in light gray. And for the probability of survival, we're using a slightly different type of scale, because remember, everything is expressed in terms of percentage out of 100. So this is what is interesting about the survey. So by the time here, you might want to skip. There's a lot of information on this slide, but here you might want to skip essentially to the last row of the table. So by the time you're doing this combination of initial risk and risk reduction, both in terms of the risk of getting cancer and the risk of dying from it and the corresponding risk reduction, we're getting a total of 15 different mortality risk reduction, unconditional mortality risk reductions, which is the most I've ever seen in a contingent valuation survey. They range very widely in terms of magnitude, from 0.39 in 10,000 to 3.11 in 10,000 per year, with an average of about 1.7 in 10,000 per year. So they're relatively small risks, but they span a really large range. For those of you guys that work in the area of checking for scope, this is effectively a mix of internal and external scope tests. It would have been impossible for us to do a purely external scope test with everybody being giving a single mortality risk reduction, because we would have had to have 15 split samples and the sample size would have been enormous and the cost of the survey enormous. But by doing this kind of mix, we're hoping to be able to get a lot of variability in the mortality risk reduction and to do a good job with estimating how that affects the willingness to pay. Here's my model, our model. So it's a log-log type of model. So where the underlying variable is the log of the willingness to pay. We're regressing that on a constant plus gamma multiplied by the log of the unconditional mortality risk reduction. So each of these five different levels that we get. Ideally, gamma should be positive and significant, indicating that there is scope, so that the willingness to pay grows with the mortality risk reduction. In the best of cases, the one that we're really aspiring to, it's actually one, which means that the willingness to pay is perfectly proportional to the size of the risk reduction. And we have a single value per statistical life that applies to just about everybody and every type of risk reduction, every size of risk reduction. I'm not going to be spending
a lot. Have 5 more minutes left.
Yeah. Yes, I think I'll be able to make it. I'm not going to be spending a lot of time on this, but of course we have single bounded dichotomous choice questions. So everything gets turned into a probit model, and actually it gets turned into a random effect probit model because we're allowing for correlation to between the responses provided by a single person. Please notice that this model could be estimating by imposing that gamma is equal to 1, so by imposing the scope exists. And we'll see about that in just about a minute. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. I've already told you that the survey was done 5 years apart in the same locale. You can see the sample sizes here. By the time we clean our samples, we have about 753 and 926 cleaned, completed questionnaires. We're using everything, of course, is being done online these days, and we're focusing on adults aged between 45 and 60. We try to do the same type of sampling in terms of quota by region, age, gender, and household income. Very quickly here, I just wanted to point out that as we are expecting from the growth in the Czech Republic between the 2014 and 2019, the household income is much larger in the 2019 survey. You can see right here that it's not twice as big, but a good 40% larger than in the previous survey. We also have a more highly educated sample in the 2019 survey, so this is going to be important for interpreting the results. Another difference that we have between the two surveys is that when people are asked to rate the dread that they associate with cancer, more people did so, but regarded it as a very highly dreaded type of thing in 2014 than they do in 2019. But in terms of experience with cancer and knowledge of other family members or friends that have cancer, things are pretty much the same across the two surveys. So quickly, the results. So here I'm separating the data by survey, and I'm presenting results in willingness to pay space so that we can actually compare this estimate of gamma with the number one to see how close we are and how well we're doing. So in both of the surveys, clearly the willingness to pay grows with the mortality risk reduction, so no concern there. In the first of the two surveys, the 0.78 is actually different, statistically different than one, but it's not really very far away from it. And in the 2019 survey, this figure is actually not statistically different than one. So we're doing great in terms of proportionality. The income elasticity of the willingness to pay is about 0.74 in the first survey and about 0.52 in the second survey. So we'll keep that in mind. The implied cancer VSL is about 4.2 million PPP euro in the 2019 survey. And in the 2014 survey, of course, it changes with the size of the risk reduction. So it goes from slightly over 3 million for the largest risk reduction to 1.8 million for the smallest one. But if we had to impose the restriction that the proportionality is perfect, we would get about 3 million. So this is what we're seeing so far. So very quickly, just a reminder, about 3 million PPS euro in the 2014 survey, about 4.2 in the 2019 survey, which of course is a larger number. It increases by 40%. And actually, if I want to calculate an additional measure of the income elasticity of the VSL, I'm getting about 0.77 just by comparing average income across the two ways of survey and the VSL. This is gonna be, so next, I'm combining the two surveys together, I'm pulling them together, and I'm running my checks of internal validity, which are also going to be allowing me to see if there's any changes in preferences across the two surveys. So in model number one, I'm just putting in, I'm imposing the restriction that gamma is equal to one, which is not a big stretch for wave one, and it's definitely okay for perfect for big for wave two. And so I'm reporting results not in willingness to pay space, but just straight as they come from the random effect probit model. I'm including a dummy for 2019 survey. And as you can see in the simplest of specification, it appears that the willingness to pay is systematically higher, about 23-25% systematically higher in the 2019 survey. But as soon as I start adding income, the coefficient is no longer significant and is much smaller. And likewise, when I'm adding other controls, such as education, which, however, is not statistically significant despite the large coefficient, and a dummy for whether the respondent is actually dreading cancer very highly. So conclusion from this is that I don't believe that there has been a change in the preferences for risk reduction, so the rate at which I'm prepared to trade off income for risk reduction. Simply that the different wealth of the sample and the different type of concern that people have about cancer are explaining any differences across the two surveys. So conclusions. So I think that we found that the reliability was very good across the two surveys. So any differences in the value per statistical life is explained away by income and dread. And I feel I can conclude that within the span of 5 years, there were no major changes in preferences for mortality risk reduction. The internal validity, I would say, is very good. I'm absolutely delighted that we get perfect proportionality or near perfect proportionality of the value per statistical life with respect to the size of the risk reduction. And we get increases, the willingness to pay increases with income and concern about cancer. I would like to emphasize that to me, this proves that actually it is possible, feasible, and pretty good to present mortality risk reduction as the product of two probabilities. Remember that we didn't have a check that people are really understanding what they're doing. Our best check is really indirect and is based on checking for proportionality, as a matter of fact, and for other type of things. But to me, this proves that this is a viable and appropriate approach. In terms of criterion validity, and I'm pretty much finished here, we compared our estimates with the predictions that are made for the Czech Republic by Biskuzi and Masterman, who are using compensating wage studies from all over the world. And actually, our estimates match very well what their predictions are indicating. And for future research, I would love to hear some inputs about additional ways in which we can actually test that people were doing exactly the things that we were hoping that they would do in valuing the risk reduction. So any suggestions from the audience and from our discussant would be more than welcome. And additional questions, we're going to be exploring the issue of fatal versus non-fatal cancer a little bit more. And we're going to be checking the sensitivity to baseline risk. So we're talking about the evidence, if there is any, which we don't know yet because we're still about to explore this, of a dead anyway effect. With this, I would like to thank you guys, and you can send to me or to Milan any comments about this. So thank you.
Thanks, Anna. Very nice presentation. And now I give the word to...
Right? Yes.
Yes. Now I give the word to Rebecca McDonald, who is going to present briefly or to discuss briefly the work that Anna just presented. And so the floor is yours, Rebecca. Rebecca, you have to unmute yourself.
Beth, you can hear me now, yeah? So first of all, thank you very much for sharing the paper, Anna and Milan. I think it's a real contribution. I think the new method is something that we might all end up using. This idea of splitting the probabilities down into two stages helps a lot. We can have larger probabilities, and I think the way they were presented in this study was really intuitive. They focus, just to summarize the paper, on test-retest reliability, as you just heard, and the results are largely supporting validity of the method. And I thought it was really interesting that the apparently serious differences you found between 2014 and 2019 just went away altogether once you controlled for income, education, and cancer dread. So yeah, I really liked it. Innovative, simple, I think, method, and seems to have been really successfully understood. And I also just wanted to highlight the elegance of the analytical approach that I thought was great. So these are my questions. I've tried to keep them all on one page so that you can see them if you'd like to. The first question, actually, you hinted at the end of your talk. So I was curious about how morbidity and mortality are separated, both in the analysis, but also conceptually. So your theoretical model, I found a little bit hard to follow what happens to people that have cancer and don't die, whether they go back to full health, whether they remain ill, and I think it would be quite helpful to make that clearer, but I'm not sure how that would work in a one period model, but just maybe something to think about when you're moving forward, as well as obviously from the empirical side. You found that dread mattered in the analysis, but I think it's not made clear in the paper how you elicited that dread. I assume it's sort of a simple scale, but I wasn't sure whether it was of illness, of the death by cancer, both, or whether that was left unspecified. So that could be worth checking. Thinking about test-retest and validity, it seems to me that you had a nice well, it was a 5-year gap between the two waves. But your literature review talked about some papers that do it even within sample and other papers that are over sort of a decade or more. And I was just curious whether there was a sense that you had of what could be an optimal delay there, because you seem to be balancing outside change against not wanting there to be too much anchoring if it's within subjects, for example. So whether you had an idea about that and where yours fits in that frame. Just one slightly picky comment is you flag in the paper that there was quite a high level of failure of the probability quiz, which I guess is your attention check rather than a maths test from how it's described. So I think it would be quite useful to know what that test was and whether there were differences in who failed it in terms of their observable characteristics, if you have it. And then related to that, because there was quite a high level of this failure of this attention check, it made me wonder how easy respondents found the method overall. Presumably the ones that remained in, you know, found it straightforward, and the evidence certainly seems strong in terms of the reliability of the results, but whether maybe you have qualitative evidence about this new method. And finally, you also flag in the paper that there's a bit of a puzzle that comes through where it seems like VSL is lower when the description of the cancer is worse. And just to speculate on that, because I think it's an interesting point, is I wondered whether the effect that you might have of there being lower willingness to pay for a fatality risk reduction once you're in a bad cancer state could just be enough to outweigh the positive effect on willingness to pay for avoiding that worse illness in the first place. So maybe you're seeing sort of an offsetting effect, and whether maybe either with this data or future data you could try and disentangle them. So that was all I had. Shall I leave the screen up, or would you like me to stop sharing?
Yes, please leave it on. But Anna, if you want to comment or reply, or Milan, if you have to add something, please.
I can reply very quickly. Yes, please leave the screen on, because that way I was trying to take notes and then I realized that it's much easier to just follow the screen. So thank you very much for these very, very helpful comments. So the theoretical model that Rebecca is referring to is in the paper, but was not in the presentation for obvious, you know, time concerns. And it's actually a theoretical model that was created by our session chair. So in this theoretical model, effectively, we have a total of three things that are really important. One is the loss of utility from income that you're getting when you are alive, but diagnosed with cancer, you're still alive, effectively. And then, of course, we have the two probabilities, the one of getting cancer in the first place and the probability of dying from it. So the theoretical model is could be, if you're recovering in full, you could essentially say that H is equal to zero. Although, of course, this is a very stylized model, and so it doesn't really look at the a span of time between like the rest of your lifetime, including periods in which you could be unwell, followed by periods in which you could be very well. So that's, you know, that's beyond the ability of that model. So we try to capture morbidity in this particular questionnaire through the quality of life impact. And so we told respondents that this would be their quality of life, like able to do anything you want, or unable to do heavy physical work, or unable to work at all, or even confined to bed for much of the time during, you know, during treatment or after treatment. So this, we kept it like very general. We didn't go into a detailed timeline of when they would be experiencing these things. To elicit dread, we simply gave them a scale from a 1 to 5, and we didn't just show cancer, but we also showed a number of other things that could be just as scary as cancer or less scary as cancer. So we're talking about car accident, the risk of a heart attack, the risk of being completely dependent, completely unable to move, and completely dependent on the health of another person for the rest of your life, or something like that. Your point about the time between the test and the retest is very interesting. So there is a paper that recently appeared in the Journal of Risk and Uncertainty and was also mentioned by Hendrik in his presentation. The paper is by Jim Hammett and co-authors, that looks actually at two surveys done with the same approach and questionnaire, but 10 years apart in China. So actually almost 11, 2005 and 2016, I think. I would imagine that there is a big change in that. In other type of studies that are not about mortality risk, I see that probably within, you know, 3 years, you can imagine that there hasn't been change in preferences. So I don't think that the literature has come to a consensus over this. I think this is going to be pretty much a matter of the type of things we're valuing and the empirical experience with the length of time that you're letting elapse between the two different studies. I don't want to take too much time going through this, but the probability quiz, yes, that's always, I'm not surprised by those relatively high rates of failure, because I've used the probability quiz in many times over the years, and I see numbers all over. Sometimes they're as low as 5%, and sometimes they're as high as 30%. What they really mean, I don't know. It's possible that you just mess up that particular question, but in reality, you would have read everything more careful. So I think that the best that we can do is really go back, retrieve these guys that we dropped, put them back in the sample and see what happens. And yes, it is somewhat puzzling that people are valuing less a worse cancer experience. Although I haven't done the reasoning that you're talking about, meaning compensating for one type of risk, the horrible experience of life that they would be having afterwards. This is something that I remember talking to Christoph about, but we haven't been able to do that yet. So I hope this answers most of the question and doesn't take too much time.
Yeah, that's great from my perspective.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks, Anna. I think you did a good job in responding. And as you all see, there is a lot of further questions that can be answered with these surveys that Anna just presented. But now we are going to the next presentation, which will be given by Rebecca McDonald. Rebecca, the floor is yours.
Okay, let me try and get the next one up. Okay, microphone's on and you can see it, I hope. Good. So yeah, thanks for the invitation and for the organising. This is joint work with Danai Arroyos-Calvera, who's in Birmingham with me, plus Sue, Yida and Hugh at Newcastle, and we acknowledge funding from the ESRC as well. So we're thinking about time preferences and the value of a life year. So to start with, we've heard a bit about value of statistical life and value of illness, statistical illness so far, but we're interested in a slightly different measure, the value of a life year, which we're defining as the monetary value of small risk reductions that, when you aggregate them, generate one additional year of life expectancy for that population. So essentially, if you want to generate a gain in life expectancy, the only way you can do that is by reducing fatality risk, and that would happen in one or more future periods. So to see how that works, we need to think about a survival curve for somebody, and I'm going to illustrate with somebody aged 50. So when they think about surviving their 50s, they have a probability that that will happen, and we're calling that 1 minus P50, where P is the hazard rate, which is just the probability of dying. We're saying at the beginning of decade T, for simplicity, conditional on having survived until that point. So that's fairly straightforward. But then what about when they think about surviving their 60s? Well, there's the probability that they survive the decade of their 60s, which is this analogous bit here, 1 minus P60, but that's conditional on getting there, right? So that has to be also multiplied by the probability that you survive your 50s to get to start the 60s and the 70s and so on. So that's how a survival curve works. And essentially, if we plot out that survival curve, then the area underneath it is life expectancy. So if I want to increase life expectancy, I'm going to need to reduce fatality risk in one or more of those periods. But what you can see from the set of three little probabilities there is that if I was to improve your chance of surviving the first decade of your 50s, that would actually improve your chance of surviving your 60s and your 70s, right? Because this 1 minus P50 is multiplying through in all the future decades. So to illustrate that just with a little sketch, we've got, let's say the blue curve is your original survival curve. And if I boost your chance of surviving early on, that's going to kick out the survival curve at every age until the end of your life, showing that this probability multiplies through. So that area is your gain in life expectancy. So I could create that area and make the same area of additional life expectancy by changing different probabilities at different times. So that means that we've got to answer a question of how would you like your gain in life expectancy to be delivered? And that's shamelessly taken from Nielsen et al.'s paper with that name. But here are some options. So I could give you a small risk reduction this year, and then that would feed through the future years of your life. Or I could not give you any risk reduction until you're in your old age already, and then reduce your risk by a larger amount then. And I could make those risks balanced so that it gives you the same actual gain in life expectancy, but it's distributed differently. But I don't just have to give you a one-off risk reduction. I could even give you a small ongoing risk reduction of the same size, or a risk reduction that gets larger as you get older. And these are all kind of map onto real ways of risk reduction that can work in policy making. So for existing evidence about this and showing that people actually do have quite strong preferences about how their gain in life expectancy is delivered, you could see a couple of really nice papers. There's Nielsen et al. And also Hammett and Tunsell. Both of these papers have established that there's a big heterogeneity in people between their preferences here. So we're going to call the first type of risk reduction, which is one-off, a transient reduction, and that's going to have a number representing at what point that one period risk reduction happens. We're going to call a small ongoing risk reduction of the same size an absolute one, and a risk reduction that grows as you get older is going to be a proportional one, and we're going to use those terminologies later. So why might discounting matter? Well, it's because even though we could have different survival curve perturbations that deliver the same gain in life expectancy, they might not actually deliver the same gain in discounted remaining lifetime expected utility. Okay, so to see what I mean, here I've got my two types of risk reduction. So I've got a transient one in period one here. So you can see a little bump, tau one, to the probability of surviving the first period that's feeding through all of these. And it's giving you this T, which is however many years you live per period. So let's say a decade, so these would be 10. And for the absolute case, you can see this little alpha, which is that ongoing reduction of the same size in every period. Okay. But if instead I want to be in a world of expected utility, which is going to be the world where people are actually going to make choices, then I need to replace these T's, these 10 years, with the utility of living in those 10 years. So this is the utility of the first period, but then the utility of the second period is going to be discounted. So I've got a delta, that's the discount factor. And the third period is going to be discounted even further, delta squared, and so on. And the same in the absolute case. So why does that matter? Well, because in the first case, the large reduction in risk happens earlier on, it's going to affect more the periods that are not discounted. Whereas in the absolute case, I get that reduction spread out more over my lifetime. So some of that reduction is going to happen in periods that I'm discounting. So if discounting is positive, and if T1 and A give the same objective life expectancy gain, then T1 should generate a greater gain in discounted remaining lifetime expected utility under a series of assumptions. So if that's the case, then anyone with a positive discount rate that doesn't care about anything else should prefer T1 over any of the other perturbations. Okay. So what do we already know about discounting and fatality risks? Well, quite a lot, actually. So there's a good literature in Value of Statistical Life, including some work by people currently on the call. And also in the Value of a Life Year, there's some research, but actually in the Hammett paper, they actually considered similar ideas, but through the frame of what we call risk posture with respect to longevity. Now that's isomorphic with discounting, so it's kind of a different way of looking at the same thing. But they don't explicitly talk about discounting as such. But another place where this really matters is when you think about going between VSL and VOLY. If you want to be able to convert between the two, then you need to do that essentially by dividing the VSL, which is inherently going to be discounted anyway, by discounted remaining life expectancy. And if you use the personal discount rate, then that gives you the VOLY. So what are we going to do? What are we going to add? Well, we're going to add, firstly, a methodology that allows us to elicit discount factors directly from choices in a VOLY context. So if we consider two different transient risk reductions, one in the first period and one in the third, and we ask people to iterate and tell us what risk reductions make them indifferent between those two things, then with a bit of algebra, and I'm not going to go through it in detail here, but with a bit of algebra, we can basically convert these convert these equations into a single equation in one unknown, and that one unknown is delta, the discount factor. So basically, as long as we know how much risk change makes them indifferent, then we can back out a discount factor. Now that's under quite a strong assumption that the utility is held constant in every period, but we can relax that a bit later, although I'm not going to do that in this talk. So why? Why are we doing this? Well, a first step towards respecting public preferences is going to be understanding them in the first place, right? So discounting might explain, so if we want to try and respect people's preferences, we have to first know what we're trying to respect. Also, we think that discounting could be one avenue for explaining why people have found very different preferences between gains in life expectancy of different types in the past. So the three types of absolute, transient, and proportional might be reconciled if we can understand discounting better. We also know and talked about having reliable measures of discounting when we want to convert between VOLYs and VSLs. And also, the UK government is currently planning to update its VOLY, so re-estimate the VOLY for policymaking purposes. And we were involved in a scoping review that helped to support that. But one of the things that we think needs to be taken into account there is the role of discounting. So our research questions. Firstly, what is the discount rate implied by people's choices? Secondly, what's the likely functional form for that discounting in the VOLY context again? So is it going to be a nice smooth exponential function or is something else going to be going on? And finally, can discounting then go on and explain the preferences between the VOLY types? And for anyone that needs to go, here are some spoilers. So the discount rate varies widely. We get a mean though that is above the discount factor, that should be a mean discount factor above one. Now that implies negative discounting, or that later utility is more valuable than earlier utility. So that's the first puzzle. Secondly, we find strong evidence of non-standard discounting. It seems to be a little bit like hyperbolic discounting, but more strongly suggestive of subadditive discounting. And we find partly that the discounting that we uncover with our method can explain the preferences between the VOLY types, but not fully. And we think there might be an unexplored role of sequences going on. So to give a brief overview of the whole project, we've completed an experiment which was not in the fatality risk context, but was incentivized as an experimental investigation into this kind of thing. And then what I'm presenting now is a preliminary survey of VOLY preferences in the context of fatality risks. This is the preliminary phase, and the main phase, phase three, is the planned survey that we're going to roll out in the autumn, we hope. That's been put on hold, that should have happened by now, but of course with the global pandemic we've struggled to justify asking people to trade off fatality risks at the moment. So what structure did we have? Well, just like the other projects you've heard about already, we had an extensive learning session, interactive, lots of training about probability and quiz questions as well. Then people made their main choices, so their pairwise choices between six different versions of our perturbations, and then they iterated to a difference for the transient ones, which I'll talk about more in a second. And then we elicited some other preference measures like time preferences, risk preferences, some sequence preferences, and demographics. So this is going to look familiar as well after the other talks. We showed our probabilities as a grid, risk grid, slightly differently presented than the others, but similar actually to the Hammett paper that we've talked about already. So we presented people with a risk of dying out of 100,000 before the reduction. Now here we're completely stripping context away. We're just telling people it's a chance of dying. I should also make clear that we asked everybody in the survey to imagine they were in their 40s, and that was just to allow us to present the same baseline risks and the same reductions to everybody for this first phase. What we're planning to do in the main phase is personalize everything, so this wouldn't be happening anymore. So you can see the baseline growing over time, and it's growing exponentially over time, and that sort of mirrors broadly the pattern of overall fatality risk in the UK. And then they made these choices between them. So we showed them the initial risk at the top. We told them how much each option would reduce that risk in each decade, and then the new risk that they'd have afterwards. So they got the baseline, the improvement, and the final risks. And we told them exactly how much that corresponded to in terms of life expectancy. And you'll see in a second, for the first choices that they did, everything was designed so that the life expectancy gain was 30 days, which follows, again, the Hammett and Tunsil paper. So here are the initial risk reductions. So you can see this quite small first period transient one risk reduction. This is a risk reduction that happens in the first period only. No extra risk reduction in the later periods. But what that means is that because it's multiplied through in this conditional way, that actually generates the same gain in life expectancy as this T4 case, which reduces their risk by much more, one-off, but much later. So that doesn't get the benefit of this conditional multiplying effect. And then in between, in terms of risk sizes, we have this absolute, which worked out at 3.7. 3,700 out of 100,000, and the proportional one, which grew over time. So they all generated this 30-day gain in objective life expectancy. So just the boring bit, the procedures.
Sorry to interrupt. Do you have 5 more minutes?
Perfect. Yeah, no problem. So it was programmed in O-Tree, distributed online as the others have been by Prolific. And typically people completed the experiment and the survey and received £37. And there's some basic demographics there that are not super surprising. So what did they want? Well, what we saw was a massive preference for proportional risk reduction. So proportional was preferred by 82 participants out of our sample, which was just over half. And you can see when you split it down by the actual specific type of risk reduction, of risk reduction preference pattern that they showed, you can see that by far the most popular was the proportional one, followed by the transient one, and then the absolute one. But there was a big split. So the first, second, and third most preferred patterns each favoured a different one of the three types. So we're sort of replicating this general heterogeneity in preferences. We were really pleased that we saw only two participants that said they were indifferent between all the risk reductions, but more excitingly for us actually, only 12 participants gave us headline choices that suggested they were intransitive. So we got really, really good consistency in the responses, even though they were built from these pairwise headline choices. So it looks like people knew what was going on and had pretty well-defined preferences. So jumping straight to the discount factors that we've elicited, we could do that, remember, with every pairwise combination of transient risk reductions that they compared. So they iterated to an indifference point between those two cases, and then we could back out these discount factors. And as I've said before, the mean is over one, which implies negative discounting. Now that's really interesting and suggests that something other than simple time preferences is going on. The second thing to notice is that this is plotting the discount factors we elicited, but we're plotting it by the questions that underpinned its elicitation. And if discounting was exponential or well-behaved, we should see the discount factor not changing based on the type of question that elicited it. But what we actually see is that the discount factors elicited from comparing first and second period risk reductions were tiny compared to the ones elicited from the first and fourth period, which is in accordance with sub-additive discounting models. And we ran a regression that seems to support that conclusion. So we'll see if that also happens when we run the full-scale survey later. So in terms of explaining which preference they had, we tried a demographic model. We found very little. So older people, sorry, I should explain what I've got here. We've got a multinomial logit model. So we predicted each of the different kinds of perturbation pattern, absolute, proportional, or other. So that could include intransitivity or indifference. And we predicted that how against a baseline case of preferring the transient case. Okay. So what we see is that for all of these other types compared to transient, people that were older were less likely to prefer them. So that suggests that the older participants were more likely to want the initial one period risk reduction, which we thought was quite nice. However, when we here we aren't including the discount factor that we elicited from their choices. When we do include that, what we can see is that the model fit improves and we get a strong positive significant effect of that discount factor, but only in predicting the proportional case. So what we're finding is that people that preferred later transient risk reductions are also people that prefer this proportional case. Okay, so just to discuss and kind of wrap up, we think we've made quite a nice methodological contribution in that over 85% of our participants made transitive choices, and that was despite what we thought were quite complicated procedures. So they'd had a lot of chance to be familiarized with them through participating in the experiment prior, but we're quite confident in the ability of people to understand these questions, including the iterations. And we think both kind of conceptually and methodologically, we've got quite a nice new way to elicit what we're calling effective discount factors. So an overall effect of time directly from VOLY type choices. Empirically, we're showing what we think is a preference for proportional risk reduction, but one size doesn't fit all. So we saw plenty of people that liked the other kinds as well. We'll see if that replicates when we use a sample that hasn't previously taken part in the experiment too. Our negative discounting finding is interesting. It suggests that timing is not just about discounting in this context. And we're interested in the possibility of sequence preferences playing a role. So it seems that people really like these sequences that become better over time. And that's not a new finding in the literature, but it's new to the value of life literature, we think. So we want to explore that more in what we do next. And we have, again, tentative evidence against the exponential influence of time. So it looks like discounting is not very well behaved. So our next steps, as I've hinted at, are to run the full survey, hopefully this autumn, personalize those baselines so that age and gender get personalized cases, which means that we don't have to rely on people assuming they're in their 40s and taking that viewpoint. We also want to add this in-depth sequence preference investigation and, of course, use our larger samples that we can as soon as COVID allows us to. Okay, so that was everything I had. I'll be delighted to hear what the discussants have to say.
Thank you, Rebecca. As always, very, very fast and very, very many words. I'm always impressed when you're presenting. I would probably only got through half of the presentation. I give over to Danielle. Please, Danielle, the floor is yours. You need to unmute yourself, Danielle.
Can you hear me? I hope so. Hi, hello everyone.
Yes, now we hear you.
Perfect. So thank you very much for allowing me to discuss this paper. So I think it was a really nice read. So I'm gonna have, I hope I have time to make a couple of true remarks, actually. So basically, in a nutshell, what you seek to find is try to find out empirical evidence about the role of time preferences for different perturbations in the survival function. And also at the same time, try to provide some insights on the functional form of discounting in the VOLY context. So my comments are going to be mostly on the discounting part. So on the differences between the different transient risks. So from the empirical framework, what you can see is that when you're comparing two transient risks, say for example, in the first period against the one in the second period, there's something that is mechanical. Because from what I understood from figure two is that you're comparing different transient risks, but at the end, you're gonna get the same increase in life expectancy, right? So if that's the case, it should be the case that you would find this equation one. So what is this equation one? So on one hand, you can express the life expectancy as the one that you presented in your presentation, which is just the sum over the different chances to get to the next period. But there's just as minor modification with respect to your equations, I just put the life expectancy as if you were starting in period two. It's a little bit like that, but it's not exactly that. So it's multiplied by this first two terms. But nonetheless, you get equation one if you transform by that simply because of your experimental setting. Now, have that in mind. Now, your experimental setting, what you're asking is individuals whether they should prefer the first, the transient in the first period, this reduction, or in the second period. So when they are going to be answering that question, say, for example, they're going to say, look, I'm going to be indifferent up to tau star. So that means that if individuals' transient risk is going to be above or below the proposed risk reduction, then you're going to be finding out that the threshold at which they're going to be indifferent is going to be equal to equation two. So what equation two here is telling you is, well, you need to give me this tau 2 multiplied by some factors that are going to be multiplying this ratio between what you expect your utility, life expected utility, if you are in period zero, as opposed to if you started in period two, your life expected utility. So again, this is given by the following two equations. So what's nice is that if you combine equation one and equation two, you end up with this very nice intuitive equation, which is telling you, look, if you propose a tau 2, that's going to be equivalent to proposing a tau 0, which is the risk transient risk reduction in the first period, multiplied by something that is going to be the ratio. It's more than the ratio, it's how much you value one decade, or yeah, how much you value 1 year of life if you are in period two, divided by how much you value 1 year of life if you are in period zero. So this is saying, look, if you are going to choose the rate, the transient risk reduction at period zero, it's because you actually value more one additional year if you started off at period zero than if you started off at period two. So, which is here equation four. Now, that takes me to, so that's the first remark. So I think it's a different way of presenting the same information that you have, but it's pretty interesting because it gives you a little bit more of insight if what would happen, say, for example, if you do not assume that all utilities across the different periods are going to be the same. So let's take the example that is the one that you have in your paper, that is exactly when you assume that utilities are exactly the same. So that would imply that this ratio between period zero and period one is actually less than one, which automatically says that you actually have more, or you value more 1 year if you start off at period zero than if you start off at period one. And hence, that's the reason why you would actually expect that always an individual that is, if we only discount what they care about, then you should actually expect them to have always, to choose always the early risk reduction rather than later risk reduction. Now, I think that there is some story to be told with figure three with respect to discounting. Because if you look at your figure three, which basically shows the different proportions of who actually prefers a transient risk reduction between period zero and period one, or period zero or period two, or period zero and period three, you actually see this very nice pattern in which individuals prefer more often the earlier one, the earlier transient risk reduction, although there's a large heterogeneity, which is one of the reasons why I leave my equations a little bit more general in terms of, well, maybe there's a relationship between discounting and also longevity within the period. That basically, that's what you want to try to analyze, that heterogeneity. But I think that you can do more in terms of at least what
Daniel,
you have
Daniel,
in the paper.
This is Christoph speaking. Daniel, you start to eat away from your own time. So as a utility maximizer, you want to consider this. We can probably stop here, and you send or you get in touch with Rebecca and her co-authors later on, and you exchange, because I think also it will be very tough to reply to all of this.
Yes. Okay.
So perhaps, I mean, unless Rebecca wants to come in now and quickly say something that she just crossed her mind or so.
Yeah, so no, I just very quickly, because I don't want to eat into your time. Firstly, thank you. This is really helpful, really helpful level of detailed comments. Thank you for that. We have thought a little bit about this assumption of the utility being constant that we're making, which is obviously a big one. I won't go into details about why it looks like it. We don't think it could explain the positive discounting that we have in general, but I'll certainly be thinking more about it and certainly be speaking to the co-authors about it, and we'd be very grateful for your comments if you could send them across. That'd be really good. Thank you.
Of course, you're welcome.
Right, well then, Daniel, the floor is yours now with your own paper.
Okay, thank you. So let me stop sharing this. I'll try this one here. All right. Okay. So the paper that I'm going to present is a joint work with Lise Rochex. And the idea of the paper is to try to analyze whether the value for statistical life actually varies with age or baseline health. So we have already discussed or speakers before me, both Anna and Henrik, have already talked that there's a lot of heterogeneity within the value per statistical life. So, and the reason why that might be the case is because, well, basically we face different types of risks that can be either environmental or non-environmental. But on top of that, we are pretty different among ourselves. We are heterogeneous, not only in terms of characteristics, but also in terms of preferences. So it actually seems natural to expect that individuals' willingness to pay for the mortality risk reduction is going to be depending on the context in which it's going to be elicited. And hence this willingness to pay, as has been mentioned, is a trade-off between the wealth on one hand and the mortality risk reductions on the other hand, which is what we have defined as the value per statistical life. So it's no surprise for anyone here attending the session that VSL is a pretty key statistic when you're trying to measure policy, the benefits of policies that are intending to increase the survival rate. Nevertheless, adopting a context-dependent value per statistical life has been proven to be pretty controversial in the past. So for example, one case in which it was pretty controversial was in the States, in which the EPA decided to have an age-dependent value per statistical life, and this was highly criticized by members of the general public, and hence they decided to back down. However, if you look at this side of the Atlantic, both the European Commission and the UK Treasury actually recommend the use in their guidelines on a context-dependent value per statistical life. So there is some evidence, or the fact that agencies decide to propose VSL that is depending on the context suggests that there's at least some recognition that VSL may vary with the value per statistical life. So our question in this paper tries to contribute to this literature by asking whether VSL varies with age or baseline health. And the way that we try to answer that question is by first setting out a theoretical model just to see what would theory predict in terms of baseline health and age. And the key modeling strategy here that we're going to account for a quality of life explicitly. So quality of life here for us is going to represent on one hand longevity and on the other hand a quality health related quality of life. So we're going to test out the predictions using a pretty rich data set that is a cohort, constants cohort. So this is a cohort with 200,000 individuals in France that has the richness, where the richness comes from. Actually, we have information on both survey related data and on administrative related data. And in addition, actually constants, they individuals that make part of the cohort actually are invited or are required actually to go to one medical center to have some medical checkups, and in which we actually know both objective and subjective levels of health. So we're going to provide reduced form evidence using a wage compensated variation study. So what do we find? We have two sets of results. On one hand, we have that the theory suggests, as no surprise, mortality risk reductions are actually valuable. However, when you look at a better quality of life state, that could impact actually positively or negatively the value per statistical life. So the intuition is quite simple. So imagine that you are in a better quality of life state. If you are going to have a better quality of life, maybe you would like to pay for that risk reduction because you're going to survive in a better quality of life state. However, if quality of life and wealth in terms of utility are positively correlated, meaning that you enjoy more €1 if you are in better health, then quality of life actually can reduce the value per statistical life. And hence you have these two opposing effects that render the question, the theoretical implications actually ambiguous. So this is a empirical related question, or should be answered empirically on a case-by-case study. So it suggests our findings when we do a wage compensating study that the French VSL estimate is close to €6.5 million, that individuals with better baseline health actually require less compensation, and older individuals also require less compensation. So what is the information that you require if you want to try to answer this type of questions? On one hand, you need information on individuals, on their demographics, and more importantly, on their medical history. So we have information using this information using constants, although we're going to focus only on individuals that are blue collar workers, that are men and that are aged between 20 and 60 years old. In addition to that, we exploit the usefulness of constants in terms of administrative data. So we're able to retrace the professional history of these individuals by looking at the data that is actually used to create the, to put a pension on the individual. So it's pretty reliable data. But in addition to that, you don't only need the health history, you need the professional history, but you need to know where or which type of industries these individuals are working. So if you do that, we do that using a database that contains the universe of different firms in France that is called CIREN. So, and last but not least, using the CIREN, we can match the fatality risk data that we constructed using a freely available data set on the web that is taken by the CNAMS from the periods from 2009 up to 2016. So we're able to compute mortality risks on a count basis, but also on different types of ways of measuring the mortality risk, say, for example, hourly mortality risk for around 720 different types of industries. Now, just to give you an idea on the demographics that we're going to be using, so we're going to be using two types of different information from constants. So on one hand, we want to be exploiting the survey data. Problem with the survey data is that at least at the time that we were using the data set, we only had one wave. So this is the reason why you see C here. This is meant to capture the cross-section type of information. But we also have panel, which is, for example, the average gross hourly wage that we can retrace the entire earnings of the individuals across time. Now, to give you an idea of the individuals that have some either cancer or cardiovascular disease or any of those, this I present to you here the proportion of sample of around 87% of individuals don't have any cancer nor cardiovascular disease. They are around 10 years of individual observations within our data. And when you look at the age of the onset of the disease, it's going to be around 45 to 46, depending on whether it's cancer or cardiovascular disease. Now, what's important in order to try to identify the effect on facing a higher risk is that we require individuals to change industries across time. So this is the number of new industries that an individual within our sample is going to be facing or changing in one specific year. So it's 0.11 for an individual that does not have nor cancer nor cardiovascular disease, but it's going to be a little bit smaller for individuals that either have cancer or cardiovascular disease. So just to give you another point of information, I think, so an individual that changes, so 60% of individuals in our sample change of industries, and conditionally on changing in changes on two different industries. Now, in terms of fatality risk, what we do is we compute fatality risk for individuals, for industries using a four-digit level. So this, again, it accounts to 720 different types of industries. The ones that I presented to you in the summary statistics actually correspond to the averages across a one-digit level. So this is why you only see nine different industries. So we don't have any agricultural, forestry, fishing industries within our data set. So here actually are the averages of the individuals within our sample. And you can see two columns. So one is unadjusted and the other is adjusted. So the big difference between unadjusted and adjusted is that the adjusted ones actually try to mimic the risks that are facing the blue collar workers in our sample. And what we do is that we take mortality rates that are going to be average for 8 years from 2009 until 2016 for this individual. So here mortality rates again are based on 100,000 full-time equivalent workers. So what are we going to do? We're going to use the following pretty standard setting in which we're going to try to explain the individual's wage at one specific period T. against different type of information. So the most important one is the fatality risk. So this fatality risk, again, is going to change depending on the industry, and is going to be, we're going to be using the first one, the adjusted one, so the one that blue-collar workers are going to be facing. Now, what's important here is that given that we're going to be controlling for individual fixed effects and one-digit industry fixed effects and time fixed effects, what we require for identification, again, is that individuals are going to change industries. Now, in addition, what we want to assess is not only whether there is this additional, this compensation is going to be required, but also what we require is changes in the different type of health states that individuals are going to be in. So, and this is the variable Z here. So what we need to observe is that an individual before did not have, for example, cancer, and afterwards they had cancer, or before they did not have cardiovascular disease, and after they did have cardiovascular disease. Again, this is the individual's history, medical history that we're going to be exploiting. Now, what do we find? We find that in this table, I'm going to be presenting the five different columns. Again, the unit of observation is an individual's wage in one specific year. So the column 5 represents the cross-sectional analysis in which we are only exploiting cross-sectional variation, and we find the fatality rate is actually positive and significant. And if you translate that into value per statistical life measures, we find that the value per statistical life is around 3.3 million euros. Now, if you use a little bit more information, say for example, you pass from pooled information in which you you use all the years available that you have available in our data set, we find that the value per statistical life increases, but nonetheless, we're not controlling for individual fixed effects. Now, once you control for individual fixed effects, the value per statistical life increases to around 6 million euros. Now, once you allow for heterogeneity, both in age and or and in cardiovascular disease or cancer, what we see is that in column, in model 2, the value per statistical life for cardiovascular disease, for an individual that has cardiovascular disease, is a little bit, it's around 10 million euros as compared, and it's higher than as compared to an individual that neither has cancer nor cardiovascular disease. And last but not least, when you see that value per statistical life, how it varies with respect to the age heterogeneity, what we observe is that value per statistical life for individuals that are younger is higher than individuals that are between 30 and 49, and also between 50 and 60 years old. So what we also find is that the difference between the value per statistical life for individuals that are in their 30s and their 50s is not really statistically different. Now, one key point that we need to take into account is that the fatality risk is the key variable in which we need to make sure that it is at least trying to proxy correctly the different type of mortality risk. This is one of the difficulties in this type of hedonic approaches. So in order to try to see whether the results are robust in order in terms of different type of fatality risk that we're using, we use a different sets of fatality risks. Say for example, we compared the adjusted against the unadjusted fatality risk for the period of 2009-2016, or we also use, for example, not on a count basis, but in an hourly basis that actually measures more accurately the exposure that individuals have with respect to a fatality risk than just having a count basis. And what we find is that the results are more or less are robust with respect to the different type of mergers. So how am I doing on time? Okay, should be fine. So what we find in this paper is that our paper provides insights on a reveal preference for a value per statistical life. That is a study that is done, a US-based study, I think it's the first of its kind in France. And what our findings suggest is that French VSL estimate is at least 6.5 million euros, that individuals with worse baseline health require a larger compensation, that younger individuals require more compensation. And we have done also other analyses that look at the interactions between age and health states and fatality risk. So what we find in those analyses is that individuals that are younger and sicker actually require even more compensation than those that are older and are going to be in a less sick health state. Now, one other key point that we do in the paper is that we check for robustness checks in terms of measurement error in the fatality risk. And what we do is we analyze a first difference scenario. So first difference, just taking the difference between the first and the observation T and observation in T minus one, but that usually makes things worse in terms of potential biases. So what we do is that we take the observation T and T minus two. And in addition to that, we provide some instruments that are going to be T minus one and T minus three observations. So we do have more details on that on the paper. And what we find is that overall the results are robust in qualitative terms. However, we find that the value per statistical life actually increases up to 11 million euros in average, which suggests that this 6.5 million euros is a conservative estimate. So, and that's about it. I'm looking forward to the discussions of Eric. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Daniel. I have to admit that I was kicked out from the system for a moment. So, but I'm glad that I made it to the end. So Henrik, the floor is yours for the presentation of Daniel's paper.
Yeah, so thank you, Daniel, for a very nice presentation. So I had a pleasure to discuss this paper a couple of times already and provide comments. And I also know that it has been accepted for publication. So I will not go into any detail. It's a very well written paper with a lot of discussion about the weaknesses with data, etc. So of course I still have some comments, but I would ask a broader question, because you state that the VSL is at least 6.5 million and could even be up to 11 million. You state yourself in the conclusions. And you have another paper on the VSL as well published where it's 2 million. And but it's not weight risk. So my question is more about how useful are weight risk estimates for other types of risks? So we expect, if we believe that there is hypothetical bias in state preference studies, we would expect that SP studies would produce higher estimates than review preference studies. And for instance, in transportation, we have seen that SP studies in general produce higher values than RP studies. But a common view, for instance, in the US is that RP studies produce higher estimates than SP studies. And it's very much based on the fact that the weight risk study seems to produce very high estimates of VSL. So you as both a researcher and someone with a big interest in policy, do you believe that the weight risk studies are useful for other types of risk than weight risks when it comes to the implementation? And why do the weight risk study produce so high estimates? Because in addition to this comparison with SP studies, we also had the fact that we're looking at a group of individuals that we expect are less averse to physical risk, the blue collar workers. So we have this also sample selection issue, a group of individuals that take on risky jobs because we expect them not to care about that much, but they require huge compensation compared to how much we're willing to pay for other types of risk reductions. So that was my big, big question.
I'm your trail. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much for that question, which is a pretty tough one. I think most of the people present in this panel will do a better job at answering that question than I do. But I'll give it a shot. So how useful the wage risk VSL-based studies are in terms of extrapolation to other types of risk? So that's a difficult question, because it's true that when you're doing value per statistical life estimates based on wage risk studies, you do have a limited sample. Say, for example, in my case, we have individuals that are men that are aged between 20 and 60 and that are only blue collar workers. Now, on the other hand, the individuals that are facing the mortality risks in the industry are blue collar workers. So that the assumption basically that you're doing when you're doing this type of analysis on one hand is that individuals actually have a sense on how risks are in that specific industry, and that is going to actually going to be affecting the individual's willingness to accept that job. Or so it is difficult to know to what precision actually individuals' knowledge of their fatality risk in that specific job is. Now, these are individuals that are in that might learn across the different years what actual fatality risk is going to be, or have a better sense with experience. So at least on that, it might be the case that it's probably a good approximation. Now, the reasons why RP and ASP studies are going to provide different measures or different VSL values, so that's a difficult question to answer. In terms of methodologically speaking, they are both of them have both weaknesses and strengths. So the weaknesses that I just mentioned for the RP are apparent. However, on the other hand, RP does have its strengths in the sense that you actually observe what people are actually doing. Now, to what extent can you control? That is pretty difficult, and that is one of the advantages of doing SP analysis. However, if you look at what SP analysis is doing, well, there you do have some potential issues. One of those is that it's a hypothetical choice, so we don't really know whether individuals are going to be affecting or actually paying what they say that they're going to pay. So again, it's a pretty difficult question to answer. Now, so I don't know if my answer is actually satisfactory, which I think it's not, but again, it's a pretty difficult question.
So would you suggest for the French authorities to use the 2 million that you found or the 6.5 million that you found? No, you don't have to
answer. So, for example, the difference between the 2 million and the 6 million. So the study that we did in which we found 2 million, initially, okay, so I have to go back. So initially that study found around 6 million. However, one of the issues that we encountered is that individuals within the sample were actually either speeding through or did not pass the scope test. So the figure that you're referring to, this 2 million, is actually based on an approach that more or less does the same that you did, which is a Latin class analysis and focus only on the individuals with the scope sensitivity actually passed. And hence we found that for those individuals in which we believe that they passed satisfactorily the different validity tests, those individuals, if you compute the value per statistical life, that amounts to 2 million euros. If you take everyone in the sample, that amounts to 6 million. So, yeah. So again, I think it's an interesting question to see whether if it's, why do they differ and to what extent you can actually have methodological issues. But yeah, again, difficult question.
Thank you, Daniel, for this answer. I mean, it reminds me a little bit of this saying by, I think it was Harry Truman, who said, bring me a one-armed economist. They always say on one hand, on the other hand. So it's really, I mean, these are the questions that are policy relevant, but I don't think that we will have the time to answer them here in this panel. It would need a special panel for discussing that question. Now we have 4 minutes left. And if there, I mean, one problem is that I lost my Q&A during my interruption, but I remember that there was one question very much in the beginning by Sue Chilton. So maybe we give Sue the chance to ask her question if she's still there. Sue, are you still there? So then,
I think
please,
they cannot talk.
It's allowing me to unmute suddenly. So I have yes. Recopied my question into the Q&A. Do you
Perfect.
Need to read it out or Henrik?
Well, yeah, so I've seen it. So you ask whether self-protection actually can be a way of showing altruism instead of protecting yourself. So wearing, for instance, a mask, you're protecting others, not only yourself. So how does this relate to altruism and what we're examining and the impact on our analysis? And well, it's a great question. And we, as I briefly mentioned, we use a public framing scenario. So it's a public risk reduction. So that means that when you answer the question, you may take other individuals' safety into account when you answer it. So there might be an altruism component in our witness pay answer. Depending on whether it's pure altruism, patternist altruism, safety, but all that, you know, the altruism aspect varies. But yeah, so if my interpretation is correct here, that if self-protection is an indication of altruistic motive, so I wear the mask to protect others, or I stole the air purifier to protect others, then our witness pay would increase here as well. So that would suggest that the more altruistic I am, the more I'm willing to pay for the public programs. Because we had a public program, it wasn't a private program. So that can be interpreted that way as well. But your question was also, could we examine this? And no, we use the public scenario, despite I usually prefer the private because it's cleaner. Because the public one here is more realistic with air pollution, we thought. So we opted for that. But we didn't include any clever questions on altruistic motives. No, sorry about that.
All right, thank you very much for this clarification, Henrik. Now, I'm a little bit torn to go to the next question, which is still up there, because we only have 1 minute left. I think it would be interrupted. And since there are follow panels, I think we have to basically say thank you very much to all the presenters. It was a great session and I really enjoyed sharing it. I think you saw the high quality of the presentations and the papers, and you see there is very much good research going on, and interestingly also a lot of research, VSL related research nowadays done in Europe and top-notch quality. So that is really something which I take away from this session. So thanks from my side, and I wish you a wonderful conference.
Thank you, Christoph.
Thank you, Christoph.
Thank you, Chris, for chairing.
Thank you, Christoph. Bye.
And thanks very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.